IVM. This is a special edition of Paisa Vaisa. On this episode, we have Hemang Shah and Pratik Jain of Bhansali and Shah, a chartered accountancy company in Mumbai. Hemang and Pratik are partners at Bhansali and Shah Chartered Accountants. Hemang qualified as a CA in 1997 and has excelled in the fields of tax advisory, management consultancy, and audits. He leads a team of 25 people at Bhansali and Shah. Pratik became a chartered accountant at a young age and specializes in tax litigation and advisory at Bhansali and Shah. Pratik also represents his clients and firm in front of various authorities. He leads a team of semi-qualified professionals at Bhansali and Shah. This is the second part of the series in which Anupam talks to Hemang and Pratik about the union budget and what can we expect from the upcoming union budget on February 1st, 2018.
Folks, welcome to Paisa Vaisa. We are doing the second part of a two-part series with chartered accountants Hemang Shah and Pratik Jain. In the first part, we covered GST, what it is, why is it so complex and will things change. In this special episode, we are going to cover the union budget. You know that thing that happens once in a year and there's so much of drama, so much of natak, so many things happening around it. What is the budget? Why is it important? What to expect? Three simple questions. We are going to talk about that with Hemang and Pratik. Hemang, Pratik, welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anupam.
Let's just get into it. What is a budget? क्या है ये सब ड्रामा? साल में एक बार होता है, मतलब मीडिया तो इतना होर्डिंग डालते रहता है, पेपर में इतना आता है. What is a budget and why is it important to all of us? Go ahead.
So well said, Anupam. It's actually, I would just put it, much hyped a commercial event. So everybody makes money out of it.
Okay.
Particularly all the media guys and all.
They do, yes.
Of course, yeah. I mean, why important? Yeah, why is it important? Because it gives a country ka ek balance sheet banta hai.
Sure.
Okay, jisme you know what is the revenue and what is the expenditure. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to revenue, you think of taxes, direct, indirect. Yep. Indirect tax, we are already having GST and direct tax.
Income tax. And corporation tax.
And okay. Corporate tax.
Sure.
So now about expectations. Yeah, a lot of expectations are there. Mm. When it comes to individual tax, everybody expects year on year there has to be change in the slab rates, which this has to be because it will be, according to me, an eventful year.
Folks, I'm going to just break that down. Slab rate is the basic minimum income level. Like right now, what's it?
2,50,000.
Okay, so that means that if you have income less than 2,50,000 rupees a year, you don't pay a single rupee of income tax. How has this moved in the past? You know, how, what was it before, and does it increase each and every year? Because this is actually an important point.
Yeah. So 2.5 lakhs, I believe, was there since last 3-4 years.
Mm-hmm. It's not been changed since the last 3 years.
It's not been changed. Yeah. Okay. Of course, there has been rebate been given. So again, that's a complexity of the finance
rebate?
Minister. So you, if you are having income less than 5 lakhs, okay, you get a rebate of tax of 5,000 rupees. So hypothetically, if you are having an income of 3 lakhs,
okay,
on 2.5 lakhs you don't pay any tax. On 50,000, the tax rate is 10%. So again, that you get a rebate. So
okay,
practically for 3 lakh rupees income, you don't pay any tax.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. Sure.
Okay.
Okay.
So this is how it works.
Okay.
Now coming to corporate tax. Yeah, I mean, 2 years before, when the finance minister in speech, he promised the corporates that he will be gradually be reducing the corporate taxation from, it was actually 33% earlier,
right,
which is now he is planning to get down to 25%.
33 to 25?
Yeah, so 33 was including surcharge, which now also effectively, if your income is above, if a corporate is earning about 10 crores, he pays 12% tax.
Okay.
Surcharge, sorry. Okay. So 30 and 12% surcharge plus education says, so effective rate of taxation is 34.61.
Okay, that's how you get the 34.61.
Yeah.
Okay.
So now your basic tax from 30%, he is planning to get down to 25%. So year on year, 1% decrease. So
he had committed to that?
He had committed over a period of 4 years. He had just promised that. This was in budget 2015.
Okay.
So it promised that over 4 years, he will gradually make the corporate tax rate to 25% from 30 right now.
And he, so 5% in 5 years.
Yeah, 1%.
And has he done that in the last year?
Last year. So this year, so, actually, corporates are paying at 29%.
Okay. Folks, there's one very important, interesting political aspect of this budget. And, you know, I want to talk to you guys about that. Why is this budget so different from any other budget so far?
So it's like to be like first after, you know, GST and last before Lok Sabha elections.
Interesting.
So, you know, like coming to Modinomics era now, this has been the last year for them. So, and immediately after that, it is going to be, you know, after someone else who is going to take the charge and not Modinomics. So, yeah. So,
we don't know.
So, that's what. So,
2019, you can't have a budget, right? It'll be a vote on account. What's called a vote on account. He can't have a formal budget in, like you do in a regular year like this. It's going to be a vote on account. Formal budget will be in July by the new government, whoever that is. So, folks, just keep that in mind, okay? We are in 2018. The general elections are in 2019. This is pretty much this BJP and therefore Modi government's last budget to the public. It is their fifth budget starting from 2014. And in a certain sense, this is their chance to be as populist or as, you know, whatever the word is.
So
what do you guys think?
Pro-public, actually. So basically they will, I mean, as I told you, I mean, we are expecting increase in the basic slab rate.
Okay,
so from 2.5 to, I mean, I don't want to comment anything on that, but
people
are expecting that.
Okay.
Then there is one more deduction called under Chapter 6, under Section 80C, where you pay, like say you deposit in your PPF account or you invest in a mutual fund in an ELSS scheme.
Life
so that limit
that
is
purpose.
1,50,000. So that, even that is expected.
Then so that means that if you invest in a specified mutual fund of 1,50,000 in a year, you get that knocked off from your income directly.
So you don't pay tax.
Okay.
Then, of course, Mediclaim premium, they are also increasing year on year. So that is also expected to increase.
Okay. What was the limit last year?
So currently the limit is 30,000.
Folks, if you have a health insurance policy, a Mediclaim policy, and if you're paying 30,000 a year, which is, I think that's a big amount, you can get that knocked off from your income. Those are the provisions as of now. Hemang is saying that the 30,000 might increase.
It might increase.
Okay, what else?
Giving boost to infrastructure, again housing sector. So last year they made for this self-occupied house, probably if you are paying interest on the housing loan, you used to get 2 lakh rupees a reduction. So this year also they are planning
principal or interest?
Interest.
Okay. Principal you get covered under
80C.
Okay.
So even that is expected. As I told you, it should be pro-public if they want to really win hearts of the people. So this is what is expected of.
I want to go back to the housing loan thing, right? So let's say that you have a home loan, okay, and you're paying an EMI of, I don't know, 50,000 a month or 6 lakhs a year.
6 lakhs.
What's the benefit right now? Okay, and what will it be, hopefully, in the budget? Can you give me some numbers on that?
So if, like, hypothetically, if 6 lakhs is your EMI.
6 lakhs in a year, 50K
a month.
6
lakhs in a year, 50K a month. So 6 lakhs if you're spending. So assuming that 4 lakhs is towards the interest.
Yes.
And 2 lakhs is towards the principal. So from that 4 lakhs, 2 lakhs straight away, you can get as a deduction from your income.
Okay.
As a loss from house property.
Okay.
And the balance, 2 lakhs which remain, you can claim it under Chapter 6, under Section 80C.
Okay.
So that currently the limit is 1,50,000.
Okay.
So net you get a benefit of from 6 lakhs, you get straight away your income is reduced by 3.5 lakhs.
Sure. Okay, got it. So let me just recap that for you guys. You've got home loan, okay, benefits on interest, benefits probably on principal. You have got Mediclaim, okay, you've got an increase in the basic exemption limit. Okay.
Exactly.
These are the three things. There's some push on infra and all, but that's more from the country's perspective.
Yeah.
I'm saying from our perspective. And I think, which leaves actually one very hot topic, okay? Because everybody, it's there in the papers, you can't miss it. And since a lot of people are now investing in mutual funds, SIP, the provision, folks, is long-term capital gains. I'll just give you a background on that. So if you buy shares, listed shares, okay, they say, you know, stocks that are traded on the BSE or on the NSE, say like a Reliance or an ITC or a Levers or whoever it is, and you hold those shares for 1 year and then you sell them, say you bought the shares at 100 and hey, it's a bull market, and after a year, you're going to sell them at 200, you don't pay any tax on that. Okay, that entire thing is called a long-term capital gains. Okay, because as long as you hold that share for a year, after a year, if you sell it at a profit, you don't pay a single rupee of tax. Remember, this is very different from real estate or gold or any other asset. If you sell that, if you sell any of these assets, say if you got a house and you sell it after a year, you're going to pay a tax on that, right? So that differential is still there. What's the long-term capital gains on, say, on anything other than shares?
20%.
No indexation or?
Indexation. It's only on debentures that you don't get any indexation.
Okay. Indexation, folks, is a method to increase your cost. What the government says is, listen, you know, you bought the shares 1 year, 2 year, 3 years ago. Cost has increased, inflation has increased. So you bought the shares at 100, which is fine. But hey, you know, you can claim indexation benefit, which is you inflate your cost to say 120, and then if you sell it at 200, your cap, the profit on that transaction has gone down from 100 to 80. So that's called indexation benefit. So you get that on which assets do you get it on?
So you get it on preference shares, you get on unlisted shares, you
real
get
estate.
In real estate, you okay. get in gold.
Okay. So
other than listed securities and debentures, all other items, all other class of assets.
Okay. And of course, you know, there's short-term capital gains, but I don't want to go into that. It's essentially if you sell shares within 1 year, then that's a different topic. I want to focus a bit on long-term capital gains. Guys, just tell me, you know, just give me some perspective on this. It happens every year, right?
Yeah. So every year before the budget, like people are like really thinking, okay, this time there'll be a tax on long-term capital. So last 2 years, I mean, since Modi is like, you know, he wants some dhamakedar events.
Okay.
So okay. People like, are always expecting. And
please don't tell me that on 1st Feb he's going to say we baki sab tukde tukde. Folks, forget. I don't think he's going to do that.
And then obviously last year he brought in that dividend tax, actually that is about 10 lakhs you have to pay. So taxing the rich, keeping that one you can say ideology in mind of taxing the rich, he may introduce long term capital gain.
Okay.
But if you evaluate it with the current scenario wherein a lot of retail small time individuals have gone into it, typically middle class families have gone into equity investments through mutual funds. So if that is the case, then he will have to think twice before introducing any such taxation scheme. Maybe he may put some complicated more by putting in some again, like, you know, like you had dividend about 10 lakhs as 10%. So here he may complicate the tax structure by say long-term capital gain above a certain amount will be taxed at a certain rate. Corporates are already taxed under the MAT regime. They pay MAT. But as far as individuals, typically an individual holding all the ultra HNIs or HNIs holding chunk of lots
I wish
of
I
shares.
Had ultra HNIs and listening into my show, but let's talk about people who have SIPs, you know.
Exactly.
Maybe. So for them, I mean, it makes sense for him to tax those people. But then this is a very, very tricky issue. Maybe some nominal rate of tax, or at the most, just leaving it just as it is, he may just change the tenure from 12 months to 24 or 36 months, bringing it in par with the debt instruments. But which again, like, you know, if I, as an individual, if I have, it's all my hard-earned money which I'm saving it, and if ultimately if I look at the returns after holding for 36 months, you know, then he'll have to factor in all those things. So it is a big like, you know, question mark on all these aspects.
Okay.
But yeah, you can expect some kind of such funny thing from him.
Okay. I'm going to, so folks, I'm just going to take this one level deeper out here. Okay. So, you know, we are aware of the fact that in the last 1 year, the Nifty is up some 28-30%. Individual stocks have obviously run up, you know, much, much more. Some, of course, haven't done well. But I'm just saying, in general, all of us have made a lot of money in the markets. At least those who were invested and continue to be invested. A lot of us are also going through what is called SIPs, okay, the systematic investment plan. We've covered this in earlier episodes of Paisa Vaisa. As per newspaper reports, I think there are about 1.8 crore SIPs in action as of now, and the average ticket size of each of these is about 5,000 rupees a month. Okay, so we are looking at maybe probably four and a half thousand. Okay, so four and a half, 1.8 you know, we're looking at a fairly large amount of inflows that are coming in purely through SIPs. And that's one of the reasons why the market also gets, you know, some amount of support, some amount of boost, because that's liquidity flowing in. When an SIP comes to a fund manager, he has to buy stocks, or he has to at least do something about it. He could be in cash, he could buy stocks, whatever it is. So a lot of the support that's come into the market in the last 1 year, 1-2 years, maybe I think after demonetization, a lot of money has flowed into the markets. Now, what happens if this thing gets taxed? As Hemang said, it's a bit of a blow to the retail investors. Okay, people who are HNIs, people who are mutual funds, they are, you know, they wouldn't really get affected because they'll find ways to figure out the tax. But for people who've come into the mutual funds for the very first time through the SIP routes, if they sell after a year or whatever it is, they're going to be having to pay tax if this tax is implemented. So, you know, I just want to put out three scenarios out here. One, the best case scenario, which is he does nothing, right?
Right.
Okay. The second is worst case scenario, which is he says, I am going to do away with the concept of LTCG. What happens in that case? If he brings long-term and short-term on par, what happens in that case? So, some worst case scenario.
Yeah, worst case scenario. So long-term, short-term capital gains currently, even if you... on equity, which is at tax at 15%, a concessional rate. Mm. If you do that, so then your long term also gets taxed at 15%, which may not be done actually.
I'm just saying worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario. So then.
Nobody thought demonetization could be done, but then the guy got, you know, whatever. Okay.
So a person holding, an investment in a mutual fund looking for a sheer 12 to 14% return. Mm. And after a year, if he's selling it, and then if he has to pay again tax on that gain of 14%, so he'll land up with just, rather he would prefer still investing in a bank FD.
Ah, okay.
And so this one thing.
So that's a worst case scenario. Of course, you know, if I were to be the devil's advocate, I would say that also brings listed investments on par with real estate.
Exactly.
And then things could happen. Who knows? You know, people who are saying that I'm getting, so if I hold a stock for more than 1 year, it's tax free, whereas real estate, I don't get the benefit. That thing might go. So it depends which way it is. The more likely scenario is that he could increase the tenure.
Yeah,
of long term, which is currently 1 year, you can make it 2 years, make it 3 years, which probably is also an incentive for you guys, you know, that why do you want to sell after a year? Hold on to it for 2 years, 3 years. How about that?
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, that is what is expected. He may bring in line with the current policy of the house, which he did it last year from 36 months to again give a boost to the infrastructure.
Okay.
So, if you hold a house for 36 months, it was considered long term until last year, but then... in the last budget, he introduced and reduced that limit from 36 months to 24 months.
Okay.
For a share of a private limited company also, he made it 24 months.
Okay.
So, this is what is expected in case of equity investment or through investment in a mutual fund through SIP or whatever.
Okay.
So, if that is the case, then actually what... economically, what can happen is a person will hold on to that for 24 months.
Yeah,
he will nurture his investment for another 12 months.
Yeah.
And then he can take the entire thing tax-free.
Correct.
And which basically, even if you go through an SIP mode, people hold in for 3 to 5 years. So then they should not really bother much, even if it is, unless and if they're dire need of funds. So in that case, they would try to redeem the portfolio, book profits, and then do it.
And then, of course, there is also... so I think one thing is that this will not be retrospective.
No, it has always to be prospective.
Yeah. Retrospective karega to fir
retrospective. He's sure not to be seen next time.
Yeah. And he could do a gradual kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
5% in the first year, 10% in the second year, indexation, stuff like that. So folks, you know, those were, that was specifically on long-term capital gains. Guys, anything else in the budget?
So from macro level, see, we see a lot of things like, we see in last few years, there has been a lot of layoff of employees. Like from industry and many industry. So we are looking for some, you know, amazing job creation opportunities. That is one thing. Secondly, use of plastic money, which needs to be given more boost. That is already being given, but still more, because that will be only encouraged now. Then third was, we are awaiting the taxation on cryptocurrencies.
Oh,
the blockchains.
Big one. We had a lot of discussion on Bitcoin, crypto. Pratik, so, tell me about all that. What's the scene right now? Like, let's say that I've made 10... Okay. Let's assume that hypothetically, I made a lot of money by buying and selling Bitcoin. All of it is short-term, by the way.
So, pehle toh aapko income tax ka notice aaya hoga. Agar aapne kiya hoga toh. Because recently, if you're aware, 5 lakh dealers who were trading in cryptocurrencies are already being sent a notice by the income tax department.
Ay, shabash. Well done. Chalo, sahi
pakda. RBI okay. has not allowed this as a legal tender in India. Mm. So as such, it's not legally allowed. It's illegal currency right now. So we are just waiting, but people are trading yet.
Yeah.
So we are just waiting on more clarification, because this needs to be given some, you know, a place in Indian system.
Okay.
To so, be globally accepted as well.
Yeah.
So yeh bahut, kyunki already
legally where will it come in, Hemang? Because they can't create a
it's a virtual currency.
No, no, no. But hold on. So you know there is an asset issue here, right? Because you can only
yeah. So
in
basically,
the language of the law, I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. So here, I mean, actually, you don't have any right. You don't hold any currency as such.
Yeah.
So it's a big question mark. So that clarification has to come.
Yeah.
So they have like earlier, I mean, they had broadened the definition of securities, you know, by adding a lot of things like even your derivatives.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So similarly, they may just put this as part of if they want to legalize.
Yeah.
In fact, they will have to someday or the other accept this kind of things.
Hmm.
Because every second day you hear of some new cryptocurrency coming in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And basically, it's a technology behind this.
Right.
So this being like, you know, they may just add it to as a definition of include this in a definition of a security, and then or maybe issue a separate guidelines altogether for taxation perspective.
And in any case, I think a lot of the exchanges, like I had opened an account with one of the crypto exchanges. They ask you for your PAN card, Aadhaar.
Yes,
so
yeah.
It's very difficult for you to
KYC.
Even keep it away from declaring it, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
At some point of time, this has to come.
Yeah, this has to come. And in fact, they have all the database, like you without the PAN card or your bank details,
they
would not have opened your account, or they would not have allowed you to trade also.
Okay.
It takes generally 7 days to open your account in any of the cryptos.
Yeah, yeah, it does. What else?
So this
you spoke
was
about
then
jobs push, creation of jobs. You spoke about crypto. What else? Tell me.
Aadhaar linking is also one of the important
Bhai,
concepts.
What's left? Sab to Aadhaar mein link kar diya yaar. Aadmi sala toilet nahi ja sakta Aadhaar ke bina. What's left to link to Aadhaar?
So
yaar,
abhi,
come on.
Now, see, that's what. So now what they are coming with. See, this is a centralized identity. So this mode, they can use it for every, now wherever you go, you're not supposed to give your PAN card now. Everything major source of document they ask is Aadhaar card.
Correct.
So they are now going on virtual. So aap kahin par bhi jaoge, you just give your Aadhaar number, that's it. No formal documents, no sign karke aapka self attested karke wo sab documents. Because now what has happened, aap PAN card aapka misuse ho raha hai. Everywhere it's being, if you must have seen the forging of documents, bank opening, all. So what they're doing, they're coming up with this virtual thing. So aapka ghar ka anything, matlab, even if you want to register, you just give your virtual Aadhaar and everything will be done. So no use of, see how passport is now. So matlab, more due respect, with all due respect to passport as well, but more importance will be given to Aadhaar, what we are expecting.
Okay.
So I'll just add on here.
Please.
Aadhaar will be like, already it has got a huge database. And this will be the basis for, like, you know, I mean, so nobody can escape the basic thing of taxation.
Correct.
Okay. Because these are all unique numbers. So, I mean, so any transaction you do, it is captured here. So whether you make payments, huge payments through credit card, or you buy a house, or you sell a house, or you make applications in your IPOs, or so wherever, I mean, they feel that, okay, I mean, this is not linked, or so they can catch hold of you.
Correct,
so basically, your database is already with them.
So there'll be some provision or something, or the ambit of Aadhaar will probably be increased.
It'll be,
whether it's, you know, in the form of virtual ID or whatever, you can, those details will come, but you can expect Aadhaar to become like a, you know, the foundation of every financial transactions.
Exactly.
It'll be the base, actually. It'll be the base from where, if so, and you can't escape this point of taxation, which is very common in India.
Okay.
So they'll have a huge tax database also.
Right. Okay. Anything else?
So we were just looking out some that government investments. It's not promoted well. So we were looking out some that we're expecting that kuch inko more deduction mile investors ko. Jisme government investments kaafi ho sake, like government bonds. See, right now there was a bond or government risk free, it 8% was there, but it was not fully accepted by the people, and they didn't fill so many forms for that 8% debenture, 8% government bond, because there is no added advantage to the, you know,
over
the,
and above anything SIC, else. You're saying retail investment in government bonds.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we are just looking that unko koi 50,000 ka benefit jo which was there in NPS, right. National Pension Scheme, mein already we have a 50,000 ka limit. Wherein right, you invest, right, you right. get more deductions. So, we right. are awaiting that. More kind of this kind of incentives or investment okay. linked deductions
okay.
will help to even government ka revenue badega. Ah, you know, ah, even ah. these people get a lot of
okay.
boosting.
Okay. Anything else, folks?
Yeah, that's it. I mean, so...
Let's hope for a great budget.
Fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed. Let's hope for a great budget. Let us see if we can, if Prime Minister Modi and Finance Minister Arun Jaitley can give us a dhamakedar budget. I hope
he
not
has to give.
Not the note bandi wala dhamaka, but probably something that encourages investment, something that encourages housing, jobs, yeah. entire thing. I know it's a tough fact, but then that's what the budget is about. Before I wrap up, Janam, tell me.
Yeah, Anupam, so we have a question by Aditya Kandala. Hmm. He's asking us, even though LTCG tax keeps coming up every year, mm. it seems more persistent this year. Mm. Do you see it happening? And will that be the correction this market needs?
Okay, so then I'll just split that into two parts because we covered the first part very well. The market is a different thing. So net-net, just give me a two-line reaction to this question. I mean, do you think this time it's for real? Aane ka chance hai ye baar?
Keeping Modi in mind, yeah, hmm. Modi fear, yeah, hmm. he may.
Hmm.
And it is too much talked about this time. So,
but on
that
other
is what
hand,
is expected.
You know, looking at the elections, we even doubt. So, you know, it's two-way altogether.
Give me a percentage, guys. Just say that,
you know,
what
I would put it as 50-50.
Yeah, exactly.
50-50.
Yeah.
Both of you
exactly,
are 50-50?
Exactly, that is.
Okay. Aditya, the second part of your question has to do with the markets. Honestly, I have no idea. I wish I could predict where the markets go on every reaction. I would be owning Antilla instead of Mukesh Ambani, but no, I have no idea. Generally, from what the media articles are saying, the markets will not like it. So you could expect maybe a short-term kind of correction. I don't know. Maybe people will like it. I actually have no idea. But, you know, this is, it's a big one. If you go into the history of long-term capital gains, when was STT introduced, by the way? It's been, what, 10 years?
Close to 10 years. 2004-05, if not mistaken. Huh.
So, you know, yeah. If you're someone who's an FI or who's a mutual fund or someone who does not support the removal of LTCG, you'll say that, boss, you already had STT. So, why do you want to bring this tax thing all over again? You've got great great pickup in inflows, and you've already got securities transaction tax, which taxes each and every transaction, buying and selling,
yes.
irrespective. So you've already got a lot of money flowing, and it's a very simple tax. It's a very transparent tax. So why do you want to mess around with that? So that's the case against this. But you don't know. It's very hard to predict, and markets don't like uncertainty. If it happens, my personal guess is that the markets might take it negative. Over a period of time, over the longer term, of course, markets move along with the fundamentals of the economy, and then, you know, so that's how that goes. And that's the last question?
That's it.
Thank you, Janam, for that. Folks, thank you so much for listening. Hemang, Pratik, you guys are fantastic. Thank you so much for coming on to the show. And actually, okay, before we wrap up, I want to just introduce Bhansali and Shah. Like any CA firm, it does a lot of things in taxation, in audit. I believe it specializes in international tax, in international taxation. You can check out their website. The website is
BhansaliandShah.com.
There you go, BhansaliandShah.com. If you have any questions, these guys are hardworking people, huh? By the way, they're not on Twitter, huh, to do all the time. So if you have any questions on that, I will forward your questions to them. My Twitter handle is @B50. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Let's have a great budget. See you.
Thank you so much, Anupam, for calling
Thank
us.
You. Thank you. Folks, to stay updated with the IBM podcast, please follow us on our social media accounts. You can follow us on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter. You can follow us on Instagram. Of course, you can always download the IBM app to be subscribed to all our podcasts. And the best way to be updated on all our podcasts and all our shows is subscribe to our newsletter, guys. Come on, just go to the website, hit subscribe, and boom, you'll get all the newsletters and you can stay updated with all the great content that we've got on this platform.
Thank you for listening. If you have any money-related questions, you can tweet to us at IBM Podcasts or email us at paisavaisa@indusvox.com.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
As you can see, we have a podcast listener in his natural habitat. Millions of years of evolution have led him to this point. He's on his way to work, and listening to podcasts makes his miserable day better. He will now head to work and use all his knowledge to communicate with other colleagues and possibly future mates. You can find more of his species on ivmpodcasts.com, your one-stop destination where you can check out all the coolest Indian podcasts. Happy listening.